On the previous episode in the series, we refactored our character controller into a hierarchical state machine, and it was awesome. But it's not perfect, nor will it ever be. But there are definitely optimizations that we can make. So today we are going to take your best advice to help make this character controller and state machine even better. Let's fix and learn from my mistakes while seeing how easy it is to add another state to this state machine. If you are interested in this project's files, they are now available to supporters over on the Patreon. And now, let's get started. At the start of the series, we programmed the movement and animation of our JAMO character model using Unity's new input system. We then added the ability to jump just like Mario using Velocity Relay integration. Most recently, we refactored our growing script into a hierarchical state machine. But throughout the whole process, we've been learning every step of the way. One of the best ways to learn, though, is from our mistakes. This was already evident in the Fall of Velocity Relay integration video, where one of the amazing community members, Peonzo, took the time to explain what needed to be corrected about our jump implementation. Definitely check those videos out if you haven't already. What's great is that the hierarchical state machine we've designed is intended to make debugging problems and adding additional states and functionality much easier. These are some of the core benefits of state machines. To map out the current state hierarchy, we have grounded and jump root states and idle, walk, and run substates. However, during the transition from our giant character controller script to this much neater state machine, we lost something. Gravity. Broken gravity would not have been clear during the initial tutorial because our jump root state was working just as we intended, and it still is. Its handle gravity method properly calculates gravity every frame. But thanks to Simon GS from our Discord community, we know that there's a gravity problem. Simon points out that walking off a ledge results in very low gravity. So, if we know the problem, how can we begin debugging the cause of our character's aversion to gravity? To begin, we can reason that the gravity issue is currently rooted in the grounded state. This deduction comes as a result of one of the many benefits of state machines, encapsulation. What this means is that the logic of each state is self-contained and relevant to that state. In this hierarchical state machine, the idle, walk, and run states weren't designed to handle movement on the y-axis, and we know that gravity is working in the jump state. Thus, we are left with the perpetrator, the grounded state. Let's take a look. Opening up the grounded state code, we'll notice that the gravity value is set one time in the enter state method. And we can see that it's an extremely small number. What this means is that unless we enter the jump state, JAMO isn't going anywhere on the y-axis. We found the cause of the problem. Now, how can we fix it? We can simply increase the value of the grounded gravity. But we have a more appropriate solution given our state machine. Wouldn't it be awesome to take this moment to showcase how easy it is to add another state to our state machine? Let's create a new root state, the fall state. In our Unity project, we will create another script titled player fall state in the same folder as the other states. Opening the file, we'll begin by replacing mono behavior with player base state. This means that the script now derives from the base state, just like the rest of our concrete states, idle, walk, run, grounded, and jump. And by deriving from this base state, we know that we need to implement all of the abstract methods that the base state has declared. This includes enter state, update state, exit state, check switch states, initialize substates, and a constructor. Starting with the constructor, we mentioned before that the grounded and jump states both are root states, and now so is the fall state. What this means is that the isRootState property is set to true in the constructor. And as a reminder, this value impacts the logic of the switch state method. We also need to initialize the substates, idle, walk, and run. For that, we can just reference or copy the logic from our previous two root states when defining the initialize substate method. Next, we can take a look at the check switch states method, which all of the concrete states define. For the false state, this logic is going to be pretty simple. We'll want to switch back to the grounded state when the character controller becomes grounded. We know this because in the grounded state, we're going to want to check for the opposite. If the character controller is not grounded, and jump isn't pressed, we'll want to switch to the false state using the switch state method. For that, we'll need to modify our state factory. But before we do, let's remember that check switch states should be called every single frame. So we'll invoke it inside of update state. Okay, we're currently seeing an error from the call to the factory. Let's recall that our state factory handles the creation of all the states in the state machine, except for the new false state, of course. So, we'll need to add the player false state to the list of states the factory can make. Testing in play mode and walking off of a ledge, we'll see, well, nothing. That's because we are still missing the change in gravity that we created the false state for in the first place. But, what exactly should this new gravity logic be? We can just set a higher applied movement y value in the enter state method like we do in the grounded state. But to be honest, we put so much effort into learning the velocity relay integration that it would be a shame not to use that here too. So let's do it. Let's create a handle gravity method just like in the jump state. We need to store the previous frame's y velocity, then calculate the new y velocity by adding some form of acceleration. We'll call that ctx.gravity, multiplied by time.delta time for frame rate independence. Next, we'll need to just add those two values together and average them by multiplying by 0.5 to get the velocity we actually want applied to our character in that frame. And I personally like capping out the fall speed, so we'll wrap this applied movement y value in a mathf.max function. And of course, we'll invoke the handle gravity method in update state. In the player state machine file, we'll create a getter for our original gravity variable so that the fall state can access it. Testing in play mode, and success! JAMO now falls. But we're not done with the false state. It would be awesome to have a new animation for this new state. Venturing over to our favorite mixmo.com to download a free falling animation, we'll find the fall idle state. To learn the full process of downloading from Mixmo, be sure to check out one of my first videos on this channel. Importing this animation into our animations folder, we can convert it to humanoid, retitle it appropriately to falling, check the loop time checkbox, switch the based upon setting to original for the root transform rotation, and check the bake into pose checkboxes for both root transform position settings. And now, JAMO can use it. Selecting JAMO in the scene hierarchy and pressing on the animator tab, we'll see the web of animation states that are currently in charge of making our lovable robot animate. In this base layer, we'll see the idle, walk, and run state nodes, which are all connected to one another through transitions. All of these are connected to our jumping state, and all of the transitions are each controlled through the parameters whose values are set in our code. Let's create a new animation state node for our falling animation in this base layer and set our falling animation. Idle, walk, and run will all have new transitions to and from this new state. For each, we'll disable has exit time and update the fixed time duration to 0.1. But by disabling has exit time, we are required to set a transition condition. In the past, we've used Boolean parameters like isWalking and isRunning. So let's create isFalling to be used with each transition to this falling state. Of course, it will need to be true when we want to transition to the fall animation, and it will need to be false when we want to transition back. We'll also need to add the respective isWalking and isRunning conditions depending on the state that we're trying to go back to. Great, now we just need to set the isFalling parameter in our code. Using the context animator, we'll set isFalling to true when we first enter the fall state and set it to false when exiting the state. like our other parameters, let's create an isFalling hash in the state machine file and a matching getter variable. Then we'll use that in the false state. Testing in play mode, and Jammo now has gravity applied when stepping off a ledge and shows the falling animation. Awesome. Before we move on, I'd like to point out a small observation. All of our root states are intended to handle gravity on the y-axis. 2 out of 3 currently have a handle gravity method, with the grounded state setting y-axis movement directly in the enter state method. Let's create an interface, iRootState, that will declare the handle gravity method. An interface is like a contract, which states that any class that inherits from it must define its members. All of our root states will inherit from both the abstract player base state and the iRootState interface. So we'll need to move the logic in the grounded state into a new public handle gravity method, and then invoke that in enter state so that gravity works the same way that it did before. And in our jump and fall states, we'll just need to make the handle gravity methods public to remove the error. What this does is provide clarity when reading our code, and that is so important. Any developer that now reads our code can see that not only do the 3 root states in the state machine set isRootState to true, but they also inherit from the same iRootState interface. This insinuates that any new root states should do the same going forward, which will guarantee that any new root states will also define handle gravity. Okay, we have now added another state to the hierarchical state machine, and that came as a result of our fellow community member, Simon, for pointing out the issue. Shout out to Simon. Studio Atma Rob is another super talented member of our community, and he was able to point out an issue with the flow of our state machine. Currently, we always invoke the checkSwitchStates method somewhere in each state's updateState method. checkSwitchStates will determine if any condition within the method is truthy, and will switch to a new state if it is. However, during Rob's testing, he found some odd results. Let me show you. Let's place a few log statements in our code. We'll place one at the bottom of the updateState method in the jump state, another at the top of the exitState method in the jump state, and then the final log in the enterState method of the grounded state. Now if we enter play mode and pause in the middle of our jump, we can step through one frame at a time. We'll see that the updateState log shows up in our console. If we stop right before Jammo hits the ground and clear the console, step through one more time, we'll see the exit state is hit from the jump state, the enter state log hit from the grounded state. But again, the update state log also shows up from the jump state one more time after the enter state and exit state logs. And that's not good. To be sure that we are all on the same page of what just happened, the frame that Jammo hit the ground, the checkSwitchState method of the jump state was run in update state. Because Jammo was now grounded, the switchState method ran. Calling exit state on the jump state, enter state on the grounded state, and setting the context current state to the grounded state. But if the current state was switched to grounded state, why was the update state log shown one more time from the jump state? The answer is order of operations. Credit to Rob for pointing this out. But because we don't destroy our previous states, if the checkSwitchStates method is invoked at the top of the update state method of a state, it will finish the execution of the rest of the logic in the updateState method. And that's even after switchState is called. To fix this, we can try to find a way to stop the execution of the rest of the updateState code. And I'm open to suggestions. Be sure to leave those in the comments below. Our solution today will be to move the checkSwitchStates method to the bottom of all of our updateState methods in each state. Testing our jump again, we'll now see that the update state log is first, followed by the exit state and enter state logs appropriately. A big thanks to Rob for pointing this out and for the proposed solution. From the YouTube community, Jasper Havillo points out that the built-in character controller's isGrounded property is fluctuating between true and false when the character is grounded. To guarantee that we replicate this, we'll change the grounded gravity to a smaller number, and then we'll find the same results. So why is this happening? To get to the bottom of this issue, we'll need to understand how the built-in character controller works. The movement on the X, Y, or Z axis must be greater than the character controller's min move distance. Otherwise, no movement is applied to the character controller at all. And if there is no movement on the Y axis, then the character controller considers itself floating and is grounded will be false. But why is it alternating between true and false if we are constantly applying the grounded gravity? If we log the grounded gravity multiplied by time.delta time, we'll see that the output is fluctuating between a value larger than or below the min move distance. The gravity value when multiplied by time.delta time needs to always be higher than the min move distance. So to fix this, we'll remove our grounded gravity variable altogether, and instead just use the ctx.gravity that we set earlier in the enterState method. By doing this, we'll also need to replace the mutation of our gravity constant in the setupJumpVariables method with its own local variable. And to avoid the one frame of locking false, we just need to move the character in the start method. Testing again, and we'll now see that isGrounded is correctly being set to true. Big thanks to Jasper for bringing this up. The final enhancement to our hierarchical state machine for today is going to be a suggested change to the state factory. This suggestion was made by an awesome YouTube community member, the White One. Let's cache our states. Opening our player state factory file, we'll see that every method definition returns a brand new instance of a state. While the states that we have aren't very complex and haven't really impacted performance, I still think that it's a better practice in this case to cache each state rather than constantly make new ones. My question to all of you would be, is this still considered a factory, or does the caching of the states turn this class into something else? Okay, following the White One's suggestion, we'll create a dictionary. A dictionary is able to store values behind keys. In the case of this dictionary, which we'll call states, each key will be a state from our state machine, and the values will be the new instances of their respective states. We can create each instance in the constructor and then replace the return value in each method. Now, we'll return the appropriate value from the dictionary instead of creating a new instance. For cleanliness, instead of using strings as keys, we can use an enum and list each state from the state machine. Then replace the strings with the appropriate enum constant. Remember, previously, the constructor would be called every single time switch state was called because a new instance was always being made. However, the constructor of each state is only called once now when the factory makes them for the dictionary. In order for our switch to the cache states to work correctly, we need to be sure that the constructor functions don't have any logic that should be done every time a state is entered. Taking a look at each concrete state, we really just need to move the initialize substates invocation in the grounded, fall, and jump states over to the enterState method. And that's it! Thank you, the White One, for this recommendation. Now that we've seen how easy it is to refactor this state machine, it's so exciting to consider more states in the future. What do you think we should add next? Leave your ideas in the comments, and while you're down there, please be sure to hit the like button to help with the YouTube algorithm. Awesome. Learning from our own mistakes is the best way to ensure that we don't make that mistake again. And today, you learned from my mistakes, all thanks to this channel's patrons for selecting this video's topic. If you would like to vote on the next tutorial that we'll cover on this channel and steer this channel's direction, please consider supporting the channel's Patreon. And as always, the biggest thank you to all of the current patrons for helping to make this channel happen. And a special shout out to Zach Etier and OneBeats for their extra support. If you'd like to join an awesome growing community of developers just like yourself, we'd love to have you in the iHeartGameDev channel Discord. For updates on the next video, feel free to follow me on Twitter. But that's all for today. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.